understand you hurt your neck. We're going to have to go ahead and temporarily remove your collar for the checkup. Nothing to worry about.
I don't think everyone really understands what goes into telling these stories. Sometimes the movie you start out with is not the movie you wind up with, and it's an incredible adventure that story takes you on during the making of one of these films.
Okay, all done. Just a Bruce.
When a director initially comes up with an idea, they pitch three ideas to John Lasseter.
He says, don't put all your eggs in one basket. And so we came in with six ideas. The thing that a lot of these films that we were pitching had in common was that they all featured animals running around in clothing.
John really responded to the animal idea.
Disney hadn't done a animals in clothes movie in a long, long time.
There's a lot of things that excited me about Zootopia when I came on. One thing was that for the first time, we were going to take those great 2D designs that are so classic Disney, and we were going to do it in CG.
I grew up on Robin Hood, and John grew up on Wind in the Willows.
The Wind in the Willows, it's the Mr. Toad film, and that was kind of a social satire.
These animals in clothing stories feel like modern day fables, and it allows us to kind of talk about what human beings are like with their animal counterparts.
Byron started with that. He wanted to tell a story of the bias that human beings can use towards one another and tell it through an analogy or a metaphor with animals.
And that really started us on the journey of, well, what if you had a character that was a predator and a character that was a prey animal, so opposite from one another, and they have to get along? And that was the basis of where Zootopia came from. From our research, we really discovered that in nature, the ratio of prey animals to predators is 10 to 1. Predators, even though they're very powerful and can be kind of scary, they're this little tiny minority. And we thought, well, that's really interesting, because if you have a city full of prey animals, do the prey animals all trust the predators? Or is there still some of that fear buried in their psyche? And we thought, what an interesting thing to explore.
And it led us to this concept of thinking about, well, what if the prey were in charge?
And so one of the ideas that was in the earlier version of the film was that prey animals only felt safe if predators wore these things called tame collars. And tame collars was sort of like a dog shock collar.
When a predator would start to get agitated, it would kind of go from green to yellow to red and tell the predators to take it easy. And that tame collar wasn't truly necessary, but it made the prey animals feel better.
It really helped in creating great sympathy for the predator characters.
We also had a very poignant moment where this adult polar bear was giving his 5-year-old son his first tame collar.
And it was a very emotional scene.
The day he becomes
a big bear.
Little polar bear was very excited to get this collar because it meant that he was grown up. But his father was so upset that he was never going to be free again. That scene was one of the tent poles that we were hanging that whole version of the film on. I still watch that scene and I tear up when I see it.
At that time, Nick was the main character of the story.
They make all the rules. That's the real ripoff.
There's a cynical character, and you really get to see his plight in the world.
As we're putting the film together, we screen it internally a lot.
To directors and writers and story artists who look at each other's films and really give critical notes and thought.
The film, during these screenings that we have about every 4 months, wasn't making the progress that we'd like to see.
Listen to me! That is not what happens when you take your collar off!
But we kept getting notes talking about the fact that ultimately the collars really felt negative in a way that you didn't like the world.
Zootopia was this kind of oppressive police state.
If the world is already this broken, what am I rooting for?
After about 5 or 6 screenings, we realized that one of the issues that we had is that as we introduced the film through Nick's eyes, since he was cynical, the audience became cynical about the city itself, and that was a big problem.
There was nothing for the audience to discover. It was pretty blatant that this guy was miserable. So it just came out the gates negative.
When you're in that situation, you need all the firepower you can get.
Phil Johnston jumped on to help out. We spent about a year trying to work together to assess what's going on.
I didn't get involved until pretty late in the game. It sort of needed a fresh set of eyes.
We all kind of agreed, let's try a version without those callers.
And many, many months into production, even though we had had Nick as our central character, we thought, well, maybe Judy should be the one who is telling you the story.
Something is going on, and you are going to tell me.
Once we started to explore from Judy Hopps' point of view and had her be the protagonist of the film, it really fundamentally shifted the film, and we just knew it was right.
It would be brutally challenging of getting it to where we wanted it, but it seemed like the pieces all started to kind of fall into line.
Judy introducing the story allowed us to invest in this dream that she has about how amazing Zootopia is.
Welcome to Zootopia.
You want to be an elephant when you grow up?
You be an elephant.
The audience needed to root for Zootopia from the beginning and see Zootopia through Judy's eyes.
It provides a whole nother level of entertainment and humor.
In fact, three of the funniest scenes of the film came after we made Judy the protagonist. The DMV.
Wait. They're all sloths?
The Naturalist Club.
In Zootopia, anyone can be anything. These guys, they be naked.
And Mr. Big.
She's the bunny that saved my life yesterday!
This bunny?
Yeah! Hi.
Hi. For Judy to be sort of a three-dimensional character, we wanted to create a bunch of stuff that was stacked up against her.
It's great to have dreams.
Yeah, just as long as you don't believe in them too much.
In a typical kids movie, you would have the character's want song where they're stating very explicitly what they want and how the world is piling up against them. And in this case, we take that trope and sort of subvert it by making her parents say the most ludicrous things.
See, that's the beauty of complacency, Jude. If you don't try anything new, you'll never fail.
We had removed the idea of the shock collars. We had changed our main character from Nick to Judy. But there was still something that we had to crack.
Maybe she is being biased against, but she doesn't realize that subconsciously she's doing the same thing to everybody else.
To avoid having Judy's journey be simplistic by simply saying, I want to make the world a better place.
We want to show that even the most good-natured person can be susceptible to putting stereotypes on another person.
Of all the movies I've worked on, I've never seen a movie make this big a shift this late in the game. But for us, it's about telling the best story.
Don't understand! I was trying to protect the city!
You were just trying to protect your job.
The story felt very contemporary, how people that are different from you or me, or how humans look at one another, and that was kind of in the fabric of the film.
We have to find a way to cooperate with one another and really learn about one another and realize that in the end, all of us want the same thing. All of us want to be happy. All of us want to be respected. All of us want safety for our children, our families, the ones we love, because we're all in this together and underneath the skin, we're all the same. One of the great things about directing a film at Disney is you get to be a part of every single step of the process from the very beginning where there's nothing, where there's just this little flash of an idea to the very end where you have this amazing film.
It is 600 people who have dedicated 4 years of their life bringing this to the screen, and it's their passion and it's their want to make everything look the best it can be that every day just blows me away.
There's something about what Disney does that's unlike anything else.